Well, hi there. I'm here today with an awesome Peter's Banded Skink that we got from Animal Ark in Orem, Utah, which is one of the great pet stores in the whole world, because we want to talk to you about these really amazing skinks. They're actually pretty much brand new. Just within the last few years have they really shown up in large numbers in the reptile hobby. This is just a bodacious skink. I mean, they're built pretty much like other skinks, especially like some smaller, much, much more difficult to handle skinks like the sandfish skink, because this is a burrowing skink, and so it's got a head that's kind of ideal for just wedging its way under soil and just moving its way in there. If they move through the soil like sandfish do, they use these little legs when they're on top of the soil, and then they just fold them in next to their body and slither through the soil, which is totally amazing. And then, I mean, they've got this beautiful yellow coloration with these really striking black bands. They're really awesome looking skinks. They've got kind of that great skink fusiform torpedo body shape that I love so much. I mean, there is a great reason that I love skinks. And then, being such a burrowing skink, I love this about them. They've got ears, but they've got these huge flaps that totally cover the ear to keep any sort of soil from getting in there, which is really awesome. I mean, it's like one step away from what you see with snakes, which is no ears at all. And these guys have got a pretty great protection for that ear. These dark, dark black eyes. What? It's a very, very cool looking lizard with just a spectacular personality. This cute little pink tongue sticking out. I am head over heels for these lizards. They are super interesting. They've got super great personalities. They're beautiful. They're fun. But is it a good pet reptile? And is it the right pet reptile for you? To help you figure that out, we're going to break it down into our five categories, which are handleability, care, hardiness, availability, and upfront costs. Overall, we give the Peter's Banded Skink a score of 4.0 out of 5, which is actually a pretty spectacular score. So we'll have to find out a little bit more about why they get that great score. When it comes to handleability, as you can see right here, we give the Peter's Banded Skink a score of 5 out of 5. Most of them are really, really good with handling, which is totally unexpected because almost all of these lizards are wild caught, so it's not like they're raised up with humans around them, but pretty much all of them come into captivity and they're just really chill, and that's spectacular. They're a robust, good-sized lizard, you know, tough enough that they're not going to be easily damaged, yet small enough that they're pretty easy to take care of and easy to handle. They're not going to tear you up. You know, their claws aren't anything to worry about. Their bite's not something to be concerned about. One of the best sizes, honestly, that a lizard can be. They've got a spectacular personality. Just low-key, fun, easy to deal with, easy to feed. I mean, a lot of them will eat right out of your hand. They're just awesome. Like I said before, their claws aren't super sharp. It's mostly because they're there for digging, not really for climbing. And so they get worn down a little bit more. They're not like razor sharp claws. And the lizard's small enough that even if they were sharp, they probably wouldn't tear you up too badly. As far as I know, they can drop this tail, but I've never seen any evidence of it ever happening with one. So it's not something that I think you need to worry about. Overall, I mean, a lizard just doesn't really get any better to handle than this. I mean, probably the only downside to them is they're maybe a little bit too small for some children, but honestly, the children that couldn't handle this probably shouldn't be trusted with any pet reptiles. When it comes to care, we give these guys a score of 4 out of 5. Honestly, the biggest problem with them is just that they're fairly new to the hobby, and so we may not know the best way to take care of them, but they seem to do pretty well anyway. They come from some really inhospitable parts of the world, and as a result, they're just tough as nails. They're also nocturnal, so while UVB is going to be beneficial for them a little bit, you know, I would recommend something like a mercury vapor bulb, because that's going to have some UVB in there. You could make an argument that they're not going to need it, at least not as much as diurnal reptiles. They're omnivorous, which means basically they eat everything that was alive at any point, including plants, you know, so fruits, vegetables. They'll eat eggs, they'll eat the San Diego Zoo diet, and of course they'll eat a broad diversity of insects, things like mealworms, superworms, crickets, dubia, roaches, basically any sort of feeder insect that's out there. they will gladly take you. We'll have links to all these things down in the description, as always. The biggest thing with feeding these guys will just be to offer a diversity of things. A wide variety is really good, and then to periodically dust it with calcium and vitamin supplements. They will drink water from a water bowl. They probably won't soak in it, so it doesn't need to be a real big water bowl, and you will need to probably change it out on a regular basis because they like to burrow and dig, and so they're probably going to throw substrate into that water on a regular basis. But a little bit of water is definitely something they need access to. And like I said, they're generally buried, and as a result, you need a good substrate that they can bury into that's not going to collapse on them, and that's also not going to cause major problems if it's ingested. Generally, though, because you're using a loose substrate, do try to be careful when feeding them that they're not swallowing too much of that substrate at any one time. When it comes to their enclosure, floor space is going to be more important than height. These guys aren't climbers, so just room to run around and burrow, and that's about all that they need. In general, these are not a very difficult species to care for, and I'm sure more and more information will be available in the future, so we're just going to get better. When it comes to hardiness, we give these guys a score of 4 out of 5. They're all wild caught. That is really the only problem with them when it comes to hardiness. Even as wild caught individuals, they seem to be pretty resilient, but I wouldn't be surprised at all to hear that a fair percentage of them will just spontaneously drop dead. That is just something that tends to happen with imports. Wild caught imports are brought over, they're usually stressed, dehydrated, and survivability is generally lower. But being such a tough lizard, these guys seem to do a little bit better than most. And once they're established in captivity, and eventually once they're available captive bred, I mean, these guys are just going to be as solid as it gets. When it comes to availability, we give these guys a score of 3 out of 5. They're becoming more and more common, but like I said, none of them, at least to my knowledge at this point, are captive bred. They're all imports. So the fact that they're becoming more common is a mixed blessing, because it means they're going to be available here, at least for a while, in the pet trade, but it also means that we're starting to have an impact on the wild population, and that's not always a good thing. They're going to be available online, even in some pet stores, definitely at expos. If you guys are looking for Peter's Banded Skinks, you're probably going to be able to find one, and that's a great thing. Like I said before, I mean, this one comes to us from our local pet store, which is Animal Ark in Orem, Utah, so they're out there. The issue with these guys is not finding one. It is finding one that is responsibly sourced, and that's the concern with any sort of wild-caught imports, is just on what scale are they being collected in the wild? How many are being brought over for everyone that survives to make it into the pet trade? These are serious moral questions, and a lot of times you're just not going to have the answers. You're not going to know what's going on with the wild populations. And honestly, that would be probably the greatest reason not to get one of these at this point. I would recommend them for experienced skink breeders. These are live-bearing skink, a lot like blue tongues. People who've had success breeding blue tongues and Gigi skinks and things like that, you're probably going to have great success with these as well. They're a fantastic pet lizard. These should be available captive bred. I'm sure we'll get it dialed in and figured out in the very near future. In the meantime, though, I would recommend not getting one of these. I love these, but I'm not planning to get one unless I'm going to be working with an experienced skink breeder. I do know some, and so I may try to get a breeding program going for them so they can be available captive bred. Otherwise, though, I'm worried about what massive interest in them in the pet trade would do to the wild population. So for now, I'm going to say don't get one unless you've had success breeding skinks before. That's my request. Of course, I can't demand that of you. When it comes to upfront costs, we give the Peter's Banded Skink a score of 4 out of 5. The skink itself is very affordable, and that's largely because they're wild caught. Almost any wild caught lizard or snake is fairly affordable because they're having to invest very little in producing the animals because they're not producing them themselves. The enclosure also is not too expensive, largely because this isn't a very big animal and it doesn't need very much vertical space, so really just floor space is all you need. I would recommend as big of an enclosure as possible with a screen top. It's going to allow ventilation. Humidity shouldn't be too terribly high for these guys, and they do like quite a bit of warmth, so if you can get your basking lights up there on that screen top, that would be excellent. They're definitely going to need a water dish and also a substrate that they can burrow into. We've already talked about most of these things. And heat lights. And like I said before, I would recommend a mercury vapor bulb. That would be a really good option for these guys because it would get them heat and also some UV. Usually a mercury vapor bulb alone isn't enough UV for a lot of the diurnal lizards that we've talked about, but for these guys that should be plenty. And of course, you'll want to have that off at night with some sort of other heat source, maybe a heat pad underneath the tank to keep it a little bit warmer at night. But I'd be careful about that because they're probably going to burrow underground to stay cooler, and having a heat pad under the ground could be sub-ideal for them. So definitely keep an eye on them. Overall, we give the Peter's Banded Skink a score of 4 out of 5. If we are successful in breeding these in large numbers in the future in captivity, I think these guys could be the next big thing in reptiles. They are, I mean, look at this guy. He's just been sitting here with me this whole time. They're fantastic. They eat well. They're tough as nails. This is a perfect pet lizard from every angle I can see, except for the fact that they're wild caught. So hopefully in the near future, huge numbers will be available, captive bred, and then this is going to be like the greatest pet lizard in the world. This might beat out leopard geckos on our score chart. Yeah, I mean, it might rival corn snakes for score once these guys are available captive bred, because they're just out of this world. Once you can find one of these guys captive bred, just buy it. Just buy it right then. Just support the fact that somebody's producing them captive bred. Pay whatever they're asking, because it's going to be more than an import. But for goodness sake, we got to support these breeders that are taking a big risk and making a major investment of time and other resources to try to make awesome lizards like this available for us forever. Because if all we have are wild caught, who knows how long they'll even be available before we've just decimated their wild population and we can't even get them anymore. So if this is going to be something that we're going to have in the future, it's because we're going to support great breeders. So support great breeders, because this skink is amazing, and anybody who works with it, probably amazing too. As always, like and subscribe. Make sure to click on our little bell so you get notifications when other rad lizards come out that we want to talk to you guys about and that you want to learn about. And also don't forget to check out our Patreon. We love the things that we can do because of you guys. Thank you so much. We hope to see you real soon.
I have to move it to see, and as soon as you move it even a little, it looks out of focus. I'm sure it was great.
Don't patronize me.
Unless you're on Patreon. Then by all means.
Then by all means, be our patron.
Patronize me. Ooh. Little inverted clackage. Mm. Has Will seen that
move? Gotta make up for Will.
Has Will seen that move?
We've moved past Will.
Wow. You're trying to replace Michelle, you're gonna replace Will. Pretty soon he's gonna replace me, and this will just be the Jason show.
Shh.
Quiet, you Houdini. Houdini, sorry, buddy. I didn't mean to talk to you like that. That'll do, though. We just need you to hold still for a minute.
I don't know what he's doing.